Hola, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo están? Vamos a platicar de The Shrouds, dirigida por David Cronenberg, este director canadiense de 81 años que presenta esta película en la selección oficial en competencia en el Festival de Cannes. Está en el elenco nada más y nada menos que Vincent Cassel, Diane Kruger, Guy Pearce y Sandrine Holt, y caminó su alfombra roja. Lo primero que hicieron en el festival es caminar su alfombra roja. La trama sigue a Karsh, que es un empresario que crea GraveTech, una tecnología para observar a los seres queridos fallecidos en sus féretros, pero la historia se complica cuando las tumbas, incluida la de su esposa, son profanadas, llevando a Karsh a una búsqueda por encontrar a los responsables. Esta es la séptima película que compite en Cannes de Cronenberg. Ya estuvo en el 96 con Crash, que gana el premio especial del jurado. Este es el único premio que ha tenido David Cronenberg. Bueno, caminó su alfombra roja, llegó al primer descanso, después al segundo descanso, entró al Gran Teatro Lumière y comenzó la función. Bueno, pues en el momento en que empiezan a aplaudirle a David Cronenberg y a todo su elenco en el Gran Teatro Lumière, se ha levantado el embargo y comienzan ya a salir las reseñas. Y dice David Ehrlich de IndieWire: inspirada en la pérdida de la esposa del director, The Shrouds es una historia de duelo como solo David Cronenberg se le hubiera ocurrido rodar una. Sardónica, nada sentimental y a menudo tan cadavéricamente rígida que la propia película parece sufrir rigor mortis, como si sus imágenes murieran en un momento de breve viaje desde el proyector a la pantalla. Peter Bradshaw, de The Guardian: es una película presentada con absoluta convicción y seriedad perspicaz, pero con menos humor descarriado que el que a menudo nos brinda Cronenberg. Fionnuala Halligan, de Screen Daily: ciertamente cuenta con una premisa excelente, pero de hecho es un día de duelo cuando lo más impactante de una película de Cronenberg es lo aburrida que es. Leslie Felprin, de Hollywood Reporter: hay poco entusiasmo, ingenio o invención que hacen que el Cronenberg antiguo siga siendo tan imperecedero, lo que hace que esta obra, ya de por sí melancólica, sea aún más triste de ver. Bueno, llegó el día siguiente y parece que David Cronenberg ya había leído las reseñas. De todos modos, estaba de buen humor. En la conferencia de prensa, digo, David Cronenberg, les dejo este pedazo totalmente sin editar, se refiere a los críticos de cine y después les dejo, bueno, varias partes de la conferencia de prensa, pero digo, ya había leído las reseñas y llamó a los críticos pues con dos, tres adjetivos y luego, bueno, ya verán ustedes cómo le fue. Ahí va.
I would like to say something about conspiracy, because I've been reading a couple of reviews and some reviewers, very ignorant, stupid ones, are thinking that happens. The whole conspiracy aspect of the film, the paranoia and stuff, has nothing to do with the love story and the grief and stuff. And of course, it means they completely did not understand the film. The idea of grief and paranoia and conspiracy, the idea that a conspiracy theory, as is actually mentioned by Diane's character, is a grief strategy. It's a strategy to cope with grief. That is to say, if you're an atheist like I am and you don't believe in an afterlife, then the death of someone you love is meaningless. It has no meaning. It just, why did it happen? Why did it happen now? Why wasn't it somebody else who died instead? And it's very difficult for people to live with no meaning. We are evolved as a species to need meaning, to give purpose and shape to our lives. So one way that you can create meaning when there perhaps really isn't any is to come up with a theory, a conspiracy perhaps theory, that explains why this person died. It wasn't just genetic or DNA problem that caused cancer. It was a conspiracy of doctors who wanted to kill her because she was involved in some experiments and was about to reveal this to the world, that she was being experimented on by evil doctors. Whatever the conspiracy is, it gives you a sense of knowledge and power, that you know something that other people don't know, that perhaps you will even be able to correct this as a kind of secret agent or a detective or something. It empowers you to have knowledge of a conspiracy. And I think you can see that in the politics of today with all of the very, very inventive, crazy conspiracy theories, that it's giving people a voice and a sense of importance, And the same can be true of a grief conspiracy. So that's really why that's in the movie. These very stupid journalists who did not see this. I'm sure that none of you are among them. I have to say that, but really, there was a purpose to it. Now, you might think it doesn't work or you don't believe it, that's one thing, but to not notice it, to me, is a different problem as a filmmaker. Anyway, in case anybody was going to ask.
Can you hear me now?
Vous m'entendez là?
Can you hear?
A little something.
Ah.
A little more.
Peut-être posez-la en anglais, la première.
Oui.
Parlez?
Oui, je parle.
I'm speaking now. I hope you can hear.
Pouvez-vous?
C'est merveilleux.
Oui.
It's magic.
Technology is miraculous.
It's a miraculous technology.
Pouvez-vous me dire?
In this movie, I was discussing in a way the death of my wife, who I had been with for 43 years, and really I stopped filmmaking for quite a while after that, 5 or 6 years. And then I felt the impulse to tell a story about it. Not exactly realistic, not really autobiography, but somehow blending my experience of her death and my loss, and with some other considerations. So that's really it. So in that sense, yes, it is my most autobiographical film, but it's not really autobiography. Well, as a filmmaker who welcomed the advent of computer-generated imagery, we call CGI, it has actually made filmmaking much easier. It's quite shocking, though, to see what can be done now, even now, with the beginnings of artificial intelligence. For example, it might completely transform the act of writing and directing. I love to let the actors show me what their interpretation is without my telling them what to do. I want to see what they come to the set with based on the script. And then if I think it's going in a wrong direction, then I do, you know, talk to the actors about what perhaps we could change, you know. In other words, I would say, what you're doing is shit. I either fire you or you do it better. This is directing. I try to be gentle. You can ask Diane what she thinks.
Yeah. I've never done anything like this. I've never done this much nudity on screen, so I felt very vulnerable all the time. And I publicly want to call out my co-star here for being so kind to me and having literally my back.
And your friend.
No pun intended. So...
Así fue el viaje de David Cronenberg en el Festival de Cine de Cannes. Un viaje, yo creo que agridulce, obviamente con sus pros, con sus contras, contestó lo que quiso. Yo creo que Cronenberg sigue siendo uno de los grandes maestros. Es uno de estos directores que hay que ver sus películas, que siempre es interesante ver lo que hace. Vamos a ver la película y ya cada quien nos haremos nuestro punto de vista, ¿sale? Pero bueno, así le fue a Cronenberg en el Festival de Cannes.